Podcasting is more than just talking. It's listening. BSing with Bob Schmidt.
It's the BS with Bob Schmidt podcast, this week featuring businessman, motivator, author of Aha Moments and Simple Happiness, Jim Ryan. Why did you decide to become a motivator, Jim?
Well, it's a long story. I used to be a teacher. I taught French and Italian. I went into business. I was a financial advisor for 25 years, but I've always been interested in personal development. I've always read a lot, gone to seminars, listened to tapes. And back in the year 2000, I just realized I had all of this stuff in my head from my experience, from reading and so on. And I said to myself, I got to get it out of my head. So I spoke to some friends, and I was directed to the jail out here on Long Island in Suffolk County. And for the last 18 years, every Monday morning, I go to the jail and I teach a class in personal development to men and women who are locked up for multiple DWI convictions. And that was a turning point for me. I put together this 12-week course, kind of made up as I, made it up as I went along, and they like it. You know, they shake my hand, they say thank you. It just fills me up to go there. And about 3 years into that, I said, you know, if these folks like the message, why wouldn't people on the outside like it? So I came up with a talk from some of the units that I taught at the jail, and I started giving talks in libraries about how to be happy. And, one talk led to another. And one night I came home from a talk at the library, and I said to my wife, you know, I finally figured out what I'm really good at, and that is communicating ideas about personal growth, personal development, without any kind of talking down to people. It's in a friendly way where people open up to the message. And it could be kind of difficult for people to listen to things where they're having difficulties. But it's been a real great run. Along the way, I wrote this book that we're going to talk about called Simple Happiness, 52 Easy Ways to Lighten Up. And I've traveled all over the country giving talks on how to be happy, how to be at your best every day to all different kinds of audiences. It's who's got a better job than me? Try to give ideas to people to make them happy.
So the Simple Happiness, you mentioned that there's 52 different ways. Is that one per week, or was that by design?
Well, I decided I wanted to write a book to separate myself from other motivational speakers who didn't have a book. And I liked the book, Don't Sweat the Small Stuff and It's All Small Stuff by Richard Carlson, a psychologist from California who wrote a whole series of Don't Sweat the Small Stuff books. He's passed away, but I like that style. He had 100 chapters. Each one is 2 or 3 pages, so it's not, it's easy to read. It's friendly. I couldn't come up with 100 chapters. I came up with 52, and then I figured, okay, that's good. That'll fit in one a week. And, that's been the formula.
So do you have a favorite one of the 52?
No, it's I've got a whole, the book is set up in logical order. Let's put it that way. It's a logically presented book. It starts off by talking about the basics, talking about our thoughts. Then we talk about what do we think about, things to think about. It's a very logical progression. And the beauty of the book is there's 52 chapters, and you don't have to read the book from cover to cover. You can open it up at any chapter and get something out of it. Again, every chapter may not resonate with you, but there's enough in there that often you'll be telling yourself, you know what, I'm going to try that. That was the purpose of the book, to get people to try some new ideas, because that's what we need. We get so stuck in our own habitual ways of thinking.
Jim, I'm just going to point out that before we started recording for the podcast, I told you that I spent many years in radio, that I can go on the fly a lot easier than if I sit down and do a podcast rather than a broadcast. And and you said something to me like, you're going to jinx it or whatever. And sure enough, when I went to start the podcast, what did I do? I screwed it up. Kind of like your first part of your book, when it says you become what you think about all day long.
Well, that's the basic theme that runs throughout the book. People think their thoughts are their life, but really thoughts are just thoughts. We have 60,000 thoughts every day. That's what psychologists tell us. But they're really just thoughts. But the reality is our life becomes a manifestation of the thoughts that we choose to hold on to, the thoughts that we continually think. That becomes our reality. That becomes our life. So, we've got to be careful about what we think about all day long. And that's kind of a theme that runs through the book. Our thoughts are so powerful, and we have the power to let go of those negative thoughts. You know, those are the first the first two chapters. We become what we think about. That's the first chapter. The second one is our thought systems. You see, our thought systems are developed through our living. You know, we've grown up in a family. We've had teachers, coaches, friends, experiences, and we've developed our view of the world and our habitual ways of thinking. And that's, if we can just realize that we've created that habit, we can uncreate that habit. We can change the habit of disempowering thoughts to hanging on to empowering thoughts. It's a skill, it's an ability, but takes practice, takes intention.
You know, one of the chapters that just kind of resonates with me a lot right now, I got laid off from my regular job a few weeks ago, and this is something that's kind of, it's shown to me basically every time that I've needed this, it's happened. When the student is ready, the teacher will appear, and that's happened more times than I can count for myself. That happens with everybody, doesn't it?
It really does. That's a Buddhist expression. You know, we have to grow. As we grow, new things open up to us. And, you know, when I use the expression in the book, you can't score a run unless you get to first base first. So we got to be understanding of how life unfolds, and every experience that we have gets us ready for the next experience, whatever that might be. So, again, it's an attitude of openness and expectation of good things to happen, where so many people think, you know, they're shut in, they're locked out of life, they got no hope, when in fact, all you got to do is have a turn in consciousness and look for that next opportunity, look for that next experience.
You know, a lot of times, though, you mentioned the word unfold, and now you're talking about looking for that next experience. Aren't a lot of times, Jim, aren't we kind of creatures of habit and just kind of go with the flow and go with the, I don't know, the easy way out may not be the right way to say it, but, you know, go with what we're used to and what's common?
Absolutely, and that's why people stay the way they are. You know, they stay in their comfort zone. Their life is, they figure, at a certain age, that's who I am, that's my life, what am I going to do, that's who I am, that's how I've always done it, and we keep saying these things to ourselves. But the beauty of the book is it gives you an idea about how to make a little change in your life, a little turn in consciousness, a little change in perspective. See, we need a new idea. You know, we keep, like you say, we keep recycling the same ideas over and over again, and we expect our lives to be different, but we need a new idea. And that's the purpose of the book, is to give you a new idea, something to try a little different. And the reviews and the feedback have been humbling about the book. You know, some people have said, things like, this is the best book I ever read. Or I gave the book to my husband, who reads it on the train as he commutes to New York, and I've seen such positive changes in his attitude about everything. So, again, everybody's not going to have that response, but we are creatures of habit. But who's formed that habit, Bob? You have, and I have. We formed our own habits unconsciously. But now, if you raise your consciousness and pay attention to yourself, be aware of what's going on, you can make these little changes. It's possible.
Jim, I got to ask then, as you look back on your life, because you mentioned that you were a financial planner, you mentioned that you were a teacher, and I'm sure that you probably had a regimen of, this is what I'm going to do the first day of class, is what we're happening halfway through this school year, this is what happens at the end of the year. Same with your clients as a financial planner. How would you, with the way you live now, how would you have done your life differently with those two careers?
Well, I look back, it's a good question. And I think as we become, mature, that tends to be a question that we ask ourselves. Would I have done anything different? And honestly, maybe, but I don't think so. I mean, my life, like I said before, my life kind of unfolded. There were opportunities that opened up to me as when I was a teacher, which then opened up opportunities for me to become a financial advisor. But my core came back to being a teacher. That's my skill. That's my ability. Is I'm a teacher. I can explain things. I can communicate things to people in a way that's that's you know, understandable and attractive. So I don't know if I would change anything. Yeah, maybe I would have sold my investment business, which I did 2 years ago. Maybe I would have sold that a couple of years earlier. But again, when the teacher is ready, excuse me, when the student is ready, the teacher will appear. And see, maybe I wasn't ready to do what I'm doing now 10 years, you know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. So all of those experiences got me ready and willing and you know, anxious to get on with new things. See, once you get in, so many people get into a rut and they think there's no way out. But, you know, fortunately, I had people who were friends and associates who were encouraging me to take that step out of my comfort zone and go to that jail and write the book and, you know, talk in front of 1,000 people. You know, it's a process, but it's, you know, it's exciting when you see the path that your life has followed. And when I give a talk, I give my background. And for many people in the audience, that's the most interesting part of the talk, that I haven't stood still, that I haven't, you know, settled. I've kept, you know, moving and looking and searching, and which is the key. We got to keep searching. If you settle, that's going to be your life.
Are you adding too much stress to your life? I see chapter 16 in your book talks about that. Talks about stress as a choice.
You know, so many people think that there is no hope. So many people look at the externals of their life and let their life be governed by the externals, and that's often where the stress comes from. You see your neighbor buying a new car and you don't have a new car. You see, you know, them going on vacation and you're not going on vacation. You know, all of these things that are external to our happiness, but we put our value on so many of the external things that, you know, we really do have a choice. One of the characteristics of happy people is intention. Happy people have the intention to be happy. They understand it's not the circumstances of my life that make me happy or unhappy, but it's how I deal with those circumstances. And that's how I try to live my life. I try to live my life understanding that things are going to happen, good or bad, stressful, wonderful, good, bad, up, down. But my life is not ruled by the outside. My happiness and low-stress life comes from inside. I'm working on this when I'm not in a stressful situation. You know, that's what you got to do. You got to work on yourself when you're not under the gun, so that when you are under the gun, you're a little prepared to deal with the stress. It is a choice. People don't like to hear that. People think, oh, no. If you lived where I lived, if you had the boss that I had, yeah, but you know, some other people live where you live, and they're not stressed out. Other people have your boss, and they're not crazy. So it really comes from it hits people in between the eyes, and some of them are you know, could be a little tough to take, but I really believe in this stuff.
Yeah, well, a lot of times just looking at it, right, stepping on the outside, looking in, and saying, okay, huh, you're absolutely right when it comes to that. You mentioned, you know, your neighbors have a new car, they went on vacation or whatever. Isn't that kind of comparing, you know, yourself to the Joneses, trying to keep up to the Joneses?
Well, that's where some of the stress comes from. You know, you feel like you're not as good as you could be because you're not achieving the material success that others are achieving. And again, you know, they've done studies about countries. You know, what's the happiest country? Sometimes you'll see that in a magazine. And the U.S. is never at the top. Matter of fact,
we never break even the top 10, which surprises me.
Yeah, we were talking about that at the jail last Monday, and one of the guys said that, you know, Mexico is the happiest country. I've never seen that one, but, you know, he said the reason that they're the happiest country is that they have their belief systems, their family values, and their religion. And, you know, in America, we're number 20, he said. We're number 20. And again, it just proves the point that the externals don't make people happy. If people would start to understand that and relax about things and just be, not to say that you don't want to strive for more, but be happy with what you have. Gratitude is so important that we forget about gratitude. We can't think, oh, you know, we want more. And if he's got more than me, then he must be doing, you know, underhanded. Or, you know, we create these scenarios to rationalize our lot when, in fact, who cares? Who cares?
You know, we're talking about happiness. What about being happy for somebody else? Is that in your book?
Well, there's no specific chapter about being happy for somebody else. You know, there's no title of a chapter, but certainly that's a positive thing. Because, again, successful, happy people are happy for the success and progress of others. You know, they don't resent. You know, I read a book by T. Harv Eker, The Secrets of the Millionaire Mind, and he talks about the difference between wealthy people and poor people. And one of the big things, as you just pointed out, poor people resent wealthy people. They think that there's something, they've done something wrong, where wealthy people congratulate and celebrate the success of others. So there it is, there too. It comes from the inside, and that's a revealing attitude, a perspective. If you feel resentful for someone else's success, that's holding you back from your happiness, from your success, because it's not a healthy attitude.
Jim, I think that a lot of us poison our own well when it boils down to it.
Well, that's it. We're habitual thinkers, and we get stuck in our way of thinking, and that's you're right. You know, everything is poisoned by our own perspective. And that's not easy to change. You know, the things like, you know, the book is Simple Happiness, but none of it is really simple because we've been thinking the way we've been thinking our whole lives. But we got to start somewhere. I mean, see, the thing is, I asked a question to my audience is, what kind of a life do you want for yourself? Because that's the reality. We create our own life by our perspective, by our thoughts, by our attitudes. And those are all things, as we've talked about, that we've developed over the years, and they're really locked in. I call them our thought systems. We have a system. We have a way of seeing the world, and they're not going away. But there's hope because we also have a natural state of mind where there's peace, joy, tranquility, solutions to problems, our genius. And the real challenge is to get to the natural state of mind when we're in the throes of a negative downward spiral of our thought systems. Again, it's there. And this is one of the exercises we do in one of my talks. And it's very eye-opening for people to realize that their thoughts are just thoughts. We do a little meditation where we just breathe and notice the thoughts in our head and let them go. Because people think they can't let the thoughts go. It's very eye-opening when we discover that we're in charge. We're the Rembrandt. Painting the painting, the masterpiece of our own life. No one else is doing it. We're doing it.
Is it different to talk in front of a classroom as opposed to talking in front of a bunch of people that want to be there?
Well, again, that's a good question. When you're a teacher, the kids get to know you, okay, and then you develop a relationship, and they respect you or don't respect you, and it's a long-term relationship. When you're speaking in front of an audience, again, now there's two parts to that. A lot of the times, I'll give a talk where people have come because they want to hear about how to be happy, and they want to understand about how they can, you know, the nature of thought. But sometimes, and often, I'm at an audience where they didn't come to see me. They're at a meeting. They're at a conference, and I happen to be a speaker on the agenda. And, yeah, I mean, it's different. It's a challenge to create a relationship immediately with the audience so that you get them on your side. And this is what a lot of people fear. Public speaking is supposedly one of the number one or two fears after death for people to experience. But the challenge is to develop rapport immediately with the audience. Get them on your side, you know. And I'm blessed with being able to play the guitar and sing. So I always open my programs with a song, and that kind of disarms people. And it's been a real blessing to me to be able to communicate. I mean, it takes practice. You can become a good speaker. Everyone is not born a good speaker, but you can practice. But the key that I always tell people is you got to be yourself. You can look, you can watch other people, you can listen to other people, you can be coached by other people. But the bottom line is you got to be you, because if you're not you, it comes through. And people don't like a phony. They want a real person up there who is honest and forthright, not trying to be somebody they're not.
You know, I went to a radio conference many years ago when I first started off in talk radio, and the presenter said that exact same thing. Be yourself, because if you're not yourself, you might be able to fake it for a couple of weeks, a month or two, but eventually the real you is going to come out. Why not just be the real you from day one?
Absolutely. And that's what people are afraid of. People are afraid that the audience isn't going to like them. hey, come on, they're just people, you know. And I've heard these silly things of to develop your confidence. Like one little quip that I read was, when you go out on stage, make believe in your mind that everyone is sitting in the audience is in their underwear. Well, it's not something that you dwell on. It's just to get over the initial fright. That's all.
Hey, you mentioned developing that rapport with somebody right away. How do you do that when you get on stage?
Well, again, I try to be me, and I'm a likable person, and you know that's a blessing as well. I'm articulate. That's, you know, it comes with practice. That being a teacher for 15 years was a big plus for me, because I became comfortable in that classroom setting. It's a little different than an audience, but it gives you confidence. And confidence is so important. And understanding that what you've got to say has value. See, there's another thing, that you got to believe in your topic, whether you're talking about neuroscience or astrophysics or gardening or happiness. You got to feel like you're an expert, that you have something to offer. And that confidence comes through to the audience, and they picked up that aura of confidence, and there's an immediate respect and interest in what you have to say.
Jim, how does being happy help a business person or an entrepreneur be successful in their lives?
You know, in business, again, you got to be at your best every day. I mean, whether you're owning a retail store or whether you're on, you know, outside sales or whether you're working in an office, you know, there's a lot of dynamics that goes into your relationships with your customers and your coworkers. And, you know, studies have shown that, you know, if somebody has a pleasant demeanor, a friendly way of getting along, they're going to do very well. Not to say that somebody, you have to be, you know, you can't be aggressive and you can't be, you know, a go-getter at all. But it just, you know, team building, you know, being on a team helps if you understand human dynamics, that everybody's not going to be at their best every day. Understanding others is a big deal. And being resilient, you know, that's another thing, is being resilient, because everything doesn't go our way. You may not get that promotion. You may be the one that gets let go. You may, you know, get shut out by a salesperson that it comes in at a dollar less per unit than you. So you got to be resilient, because if you start to go down that negativity spiral, you just go into a cocoon, and it's tough to get out of it. So, you know, having the intention to have a good day every day is important in business, because, you know, it's a people business, is people.
What makes you happy, Jim?
What makes me happy?
Yeah.
I'm happy as soon as I wake up in the morning. I'm grateful. I wake up in the morning and I say, thank God I can get out of bed by myself. This is my life. Every little moment, I try to be grateful for the moment, not worrying about what might happen, what did happen, but living in the moment and just being grateful for whatever is going on. You know, So I wake up in the morning and I give thanks for my ability to get out of bed by myself. I go down to the shower. I thank God for the hot water, because we had Superstorm Sandy here on Long Island about 5 years ago, who devastated homes on the South Shore, and we lost power for a week. I live in, you know, wasn't the area wasn't devastated, but we lost our power. How do you think I felt when I turned the switch and the light came on? I was cheering when we had power again. So now I use that hot water as a trigger to say, you know, to be grateful. I go down to my closet, pull out some clothes that make me look good. Maybe not that good, but I'm grateful for what I've got. See, gratitude is such a key to happiness. So I can sit and quietly and just be happy because of who I am, because of the blessings that I have in my life, because of my talents, my God-given abilities. It's really simple if we just let it be simple instead of complicating it by having all these, you know, external things that don't happen that make us sad.
What about the ability to laugh at yourself? Is that a positive thing?
Oh, absolutely. You know, that's one of the huge things. We take ourselves so seriously. You know, we decide that we revel in our own importance when we lose sight of the fact that we're all in this together. There's nobody better than anybody else. You know, Wayne Dyer said it very well. He says, integrity is not being better than somebody else, but being better than you were yesterday. And, you know, I have this expression that very little of the stuff that I say is my own original thinking. You know, I've borrowed from everybody. And the question is, you know, it's not win or lose, but it's win or learn. You know, what can I learn from a situation rather than going into my cocoon and feeling sorry for myself? It's, you know, taking yourself seriously, it just causes all kinds of problems. Road rage is one of those things. You know, we get into the car and all of a sudden, you know, we're somebody that we really aren't, or our true self reveals itself. And I have this little thing that I say to myself when somebody bothers me. If somebody cuts in front of me in the supermarket, or somebody, you know, takes the last, hero that I wanted from the deli, I'll say to myself, God loves that person as much as he loves you. So it kind of pulls me back from the fray and it helps me realize that, you know, it's not such a big deal. Right. And I'll be driving in the car with my wife out to an outlet mall here on Long Island, and somebody will cut me off, and I'll beat the horn and I'll start cursing at him. Why are you? And, you know, he cuts me off and my wife will say to me, but Jim, don't forget, God loves that person as much as he loves you. So I have to laugh. It's good right. to have somebody as a reminder to pull you back a little bit. Not to demean you, but just, you know, to pop your balloon a little bit, because we're not so important. Everybody's important. It's Absolutely. A beautiful thing when you can realize that.
Absolutely. You know, you've mentioned gratitude a couple of different times in your answers. I spoke last week to Mae McCarthy. She wrote the book, The Gratitude Formula, a 7-step success system to create a life that you love. That was actually my last podcast prior to yours. Very interesting. She was a really good guest if you're into gratitude and that whole piece.
Well, that's it. You know, people ask me, Jim, I want to be happy. You know, how do I do it? And I always give them two things. Number one, you got to want to be happy. Intention. You got to want to be happy. Abraham Lincoln said most folks are about as happy as they make up their minds to be. So that's the first thing. You got to want to be happy, and you got to understand it's possible. The second thing I say is gratitude is the place to start. You know, we all, and I ask when I begin a talk, I'll always ask the question, I'll pose to the audience, raise your hand if you'd rather not feel good during the day. Raise your hand. Nobody raises their hand. And I say, come on, I know you're out there. But nobody raises their hand, because it's just, we all want to feel good. And gratitude is such an easy, simple, accessible way to feel good. It's a habit that we can form in our daily life. You know, by focusing on gratitude, we feel good. And see, there's another expression, energy flows where attention goes. So if I'm focusing on what I'm grateful for, my life is good. And if I'm focusing on my lack, on what I don't have, guess what? My life is going to be less than perfect, a lot less than perfect. And when you focus on, when you develop that habit of gratitude, attitude of gratitude, however you want to say it, and you're looking for the good things, your life is good. I don't care. The other things are still there. The bad things haven't disappeared, but you're not paying attention. You're not focusing on them. You're not giving them your attention, so your life is good. So gratitude is the place to start. You know, I wake up in the morning, and I my feet hit the floor, thank God, I can get out of bed by myself. And the second thing I say is, I wonder what good is going to come my way today. You know, I'm looking for good things to happen versus stress. Whoa, no, I got to do this. I got to do that. But what's the traffic going to be like? What's the weather going to be like? What kind of mood is my boss going to be in? I'm looking for good things to happen. The other stuff is still going to be there, but it doesn't bother me because I'm focusing on my gratitude.
Jim, what are some of the strategies that we can use to help ourselves to have simple happiness?
Well, one thing is to, you know, develop this attitude of gratitude. And the big thing is to be aware of how you're doing. You're living in the moment. Self-awareness is such a big deal. You know, if we're not paying attention, we're not going to make any progress. So many people just live by default. You know, they get up, they go to work, they come home, have a bite to eat, watch a little TV, go to bed. They never do anything to create a better life for themselves. It's always the same stuff. And you know, reading is such a powerful tool, or podcasts like this is such a powerful tool to get a new idea. And in my book, I have a whole section of strategies, of things people can do that occur in the daily life of us, not every day, but you know, that just like I just said, having that little expression, when you start to feel yourself losing your temper, your patience, say to yourself, God loves that person as much as he loves me. Or, you know, I did a talk at a library a number of years ago, and we were talking about how our feelings. And one of the things I talked about is when you have a feeling of something that happened years ago and it still bothers you, who's responsible? You are. You know, and I use the example of there was a party on the street and your kid didn't get invited. All the other kids in the neighborhood got invited and your kid didn't get invited. And it hurt. It bothered you. And it bothered your kid too. And here it is 3 years later, and whenever you see the father of the person who had the party, that anger, those ill feelings are come to the top again, and you feel that anger and that sadness. So I said, and a woman in the audience said, you know, when you let something bother you that happened that long ago, you know what that's like? She said, that's like letting that person live in your head rent-free, you know? And we do that. We hold on to these negative things that happened years ago, and we're doing it to ourselves. If I went over to that father and I started to, you know, say to have a conversation, I said, you know, remember that party 3 years ago when you didn't invite my kid? What would he say? He said, what are you talking about? It's totally gone from his experience, but you're carrying it. You know, we do it to ourselves so often. And that's a real, you know, common thread of relationships that they get soured because what somebody said 10 years ago. It's nuts.
You know, one of the best things that I ever did for myself is I ran into somebody that I was holding a grudge against for years. And I went up to him and I said, you know what? I forgive you. And he looked at me like I was crazy. And he goes, for what? And I explained it to him. He goes, oh. And I'll tell you what, Jim, after that moment, big weight was lifted off my shoulders. Huge weight.
That's it. Yeah, we carry it around like a burden. And that's what our negative thoughts do to us. They weigh us down. They keep us from experiencing the joy and the happiness that's available to us every day.
Next question I have for you, what's the best purchase you have ever made?
The best purchase I've ever made, my guitar. I think my guitar is the best purchase I've ever made. I've had it for, you know, 50 years, and it's just and learning to play that guitar has brought me hours and of endless joy and experience and confidence and, you know, self-esteem. I think that's the best thing I've ever purchased. I didn't really purchase it. My parents purchased it for me as a graduation present. That's another thing. One of the chapters in the book is don't let your music, but don't die with your music still in you. Don't die with your music still in you. You know, we've all got gifts. We've all got talents. And stepping out of our comfort zone and expanding our horizons can be a source of happiness and confidence and good feeling. Because I say to people, what do people regret when they get old? Do they regret what they did or what they didn't do? And everybody says, yeah, they regret what they didn't do. So follow your bliss. There's another chapter in the book. Follow your bliss. So many things people can do. Yeah, you got to read my book. That's the thing. They're all in the book. And one at a time, you're gonna open your eyes and you're going to say, you know what? That's a good idea. I'm going to do it. And all of a sudden, your life starts to get better, little by little.
The book is called Simple Happiness. What are three takeaways we can get from the book, Jim?
Three takeaways. I'm responsible. It's my life. I can't blame anybody for my happiness. That's number one. I'm responsible. Number two is gratitude is the place to start. You got to be grateful. And that's a recurring theme, as you have pointed out. You know, it's so important to feel good, to feel grateful, to make up a gratitude list. And the third thing, take a chance. Step out of your comfort zone. Volunteer. There's another thing in my book. There's a whole chapter about volunteering. Do something for somebody else without being paid. What a powerful activity that is. it gives you a good feeling, number one, because you're giving of yourself, your time, your talent, your financial assets to somebody else in hopes that their life will be better. Number one, you feel good by giving. And number two, it gives you perspective. So many people who are sad, depressed, you know, angry, if they go and visit a nursing home, they go to a pet shelter, they go and they see that there's a lot of people worse off than they are. It gives you perspective. So, I mean, I could go on. There's all kinds of good things you can do, but take responsibility for your life. Don't blame anybody. Be grateful and get out and do something for somebody else.
I'm sure there's probably 52 takeaways.
Again, everybody takes away something different, and that's the beauty of it.
Right on. Book is called Simple Happiness. Jim Ryan is my guest. Jim, where can we pick up your book?
You can get it on Amazon. It's available in a soft cover, and it's available as an ebook on Kindle. You can also get it on any of the other Barnes & Noble or other e-reader sites. You can go to my website. There's a lot of information on my website. It's simply jimryantalks.com, jimryantalks.com. You can get the book on my website as well, and if you get it through my website, I'll sign a copy and send it to you. And you can, and as you said in the beginning, every Wednesday I send out a little aha moment, an uplifting thought, something positive to help you get through the week. People like them. They're free. You can sign up on my website on the front page. There's a little place you can enter your email address, and you'll hear from me every Wednesday. You can always unsubscribe if it gets to be too much. But good stuff, good stuff. Happiness is a choice. It's that simple.
The BSing with Bob Schmidt podcast is brought to you by Orange Computer. Find them online at orangecomputerlax.com. This has been another podcast for hire.com production.